So, I'm surprised that chair wrestling never really caught on after this, because you also have a chair wrestling scene in Julian.
Yeah, that's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Sports.
Actually, just I think we can see sort of your same modus operandi there at work. It's people that you know. Some people may recognize the guy that told the little rhyme is Mark Gonzalez, the skateboarder.
The guy that fights the chair.
Oh, is the guy that fights the chair.
Yeah, the guy that
fights
the chair.
Oh, that's Mark.
Chair.
Okay. Mark Gonzalez, the skateboarder artist.
Yeah, he was a, you know, he was a good friend of mine, but also as a hero of mine growing up. He's one of the best skaters and is really good, is a good artist. And
but he lives in
he lives in New York now, but he was living in Los Angeles.
So you just brought him in for the
yeah,
movie.
You know, yeah. And what happened was with Mark, he was one of the greatest chair wrestlers that I'd seen. I mean, he would fight chairs like most people fight. Well, I don't know what most people fight, but he would fight chairs really well. And
so you got it from him, basically.
Yeah, that was from him.
Okay.
Because Mark was this it was like a great chair wrestler. And I'd actually seen times where the chair got beat him. Which is even stranger than that. So I flew him in, and the other guys I met in this bowling alley. And, you know, again, we filmed that on the last day.
Yeah. So you were friends with him and Little Brian, and the rest
Yeah,
were.
you know, yeah. And I just want to, you know, I start to, I like, see things in my head a certain way, and I imagine. One of the things I always do is I just imagine what people maybe from different places with specific talents, and you know, I kind of
In a different context.
yeah, and I
Yeah.
can create the context again. But you know, the thing is, like, this guy taught me these chords on a guitar once, and they were like these magic chords. And you know, I don't really play guitar, but it really helped my technique. Now, I can't really repeat what I was taught, but I use a similar technique when I'm setting up these scenes.
Based on how you learned the magic
Well,
chords.
just like the stuff this guy taught me. I use that technique in just about everything I do nowadays. I've applied
Sounds
to
a
my
little ar
personal
sounds
life.
a little arcane, but
Well, this guy was a really good guitar player.
Is there a mystical element to your work, would you say, at all? Do you believe in mysticism?
What do you mean?
I don't
Like
know.
Enya video? Enya? I don't know.
I think you've answered that. Okay. And just before we leave, Gummo, I just want to talk. Could you talk a little about working with your DP for Gummo, Jean-Yves Escoffier, who died prematurely of a heart attack a couple of years ago?
No, not of a heart attack. He died. It was really, Escoffier to me was like the greatest DP. I mean, he was just.
Tell us what else you shot.
He did these Léos Carax films. Les Amants de Pont-Neuf and Mauvaise Song and Boy Meets Girl. And I immediately, when I first had seen Les Amants de Pont-Neuf, I saw it when I first moved to New York. And there was something about his photography in that movie. It took 4 years to shoot that. And Léos Carax was one of my favorite directors as well. But there was something that I knew. There was like an innate understanding of light and camera movement, and there was something that, like, in his photography that I hadn't seen before. Like, it was like he could do everything. The camera would just always seem to be in the right place, and it was like real life but more poetic. You know, it was like it was like truth but accentuated. You know, and so immediately I knew that he would understand what I wanted to do. And he was a small Frenchman. And for him, when I took him there, when I took him to Nashville, it was like a third world country for him. So what was good was that
He'd never been to.
No, he'd never seen stuff like that and those kinds of characters. And also, it was important because I wanted the person that was photographing the movie, I needed to look at it with a I was familiar with these people and the things that they did, and it didn't seem so outrageous to me. But, you know, for him, it was really, you know, he's a breeder. And so it was, he was looking at it differently. Anyway, he, you know, we both, something, he died like 2 years ago. He had a brain aneurysm, like something just went off in his brain. And he said he died with a smile on his face. So.
Okay, before we're going to move on to Julian Donkey Boy. There's something. Oh, yeah, just one more thing about Jean-Yves Escoffier. So when you were shooting, obviously you have this process where, like, was there days when you would actually not even shoot anything?
No, we shot every day.
Oh, you shot every day.
Yeah, yeah.
But he was...
But what, so, I mean, what I meant when I would save stuff for the last day is that I would just improvise scene. If we couldn't shoot the scene I wanted to shoot, I would improvise other scenes. Or we were always working, but it was just we would do other things.
Okay, so obviously he was totally attuned with your process.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to Harmony's second feature film, which is Julian Donkey Boy, and we'll show a clip from that. I really love that scene. I visited you on the set of Julian Donkey Boy and wrote a piece about it for Index Magazine. And what struck me partly about that scene was, like, I mean, it's so beautifully shot and you know, this beautiful field that she's in. But actually, that was just like this random field right beside your grandmother's house that, like, in the middle of Queens, right? So it's like, I mean, for me, it seems like you made a big transition with Julian Donkey Boy aesthetically, so that not only because of, like, it being a dogma film, but because you shot in digital and you did a lot of cross-processing and again, you used a variety of cameras and formats and stuff like that. But the one thing I love about it is that because you were using all this cross-processing and the grain and everything, it looks more like an old school film than a lot of new films do, because new film technology, I mean, the resolution is so high and the grain has disappeared. So, and the way, you know, modern films are lit so broadly, it almost just looks like video. Whereas with your cross-processing and digital, you're almost going back to an older film.